الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. أما بعد, first of all, I would like to apologize for being late. Being late is not a good sign. If it's due to a person not looking at being on time as being positive, if something is beyond your ability, then you can't be blamed. But being late is a problem. What I want to talk to the community about today, and there's absolutely no exception with what I'm going to talk about today, touches everybody. So it's really an important message, especially for you young people, but for all of us. The vast majority of Muslims are not Arabs, and they're not Arabic-speaking people. When Allah revealed the Quran, when He sent Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah knew that the majority of Muslims were not going to be Arabs. And although that is the case, every Muslim who's not an Arab, and even the Arabs themselves, we have to make an effort in order to try to increase our Arabic and the religious terminology in Palestine. The Arabic language, it is one of the main keys to a person understanding this religion. It doesn't mean that if you're an Arab, you understand the religion. I know some Arabs who are extremely ignorant. They're more ignorant than the donkeys where they come from. But the religion of Islam, the Quran, has been revealed in the Arabic language. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke Arabic, and as a result of that, every single Muslim has to try to increase his knowledge of the Arabic language. He doesn't have to become like some of the great linguists from the Arabs, Sibawayh, Farazda. Doesn't have to be like Ibn Jarir, it doesn't have to be like that. But he has to learn as much as he can possibly learn concerning the Arabic language. So there's a concept that we're going to deal with today. A new vocabulary word for many of you, maybe for most of you. And this concept is extremely important. It is what the scholars of Islam called al-maqasid al-shar'iyya. Al-maqasid al-shar'iyya. The goals and the objectives of the religion of Islam and their meaning. We're only going to talk about one today, inshallah. When Allah revealed that Quran, and when the Prophet came, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he lived with his people in Mecca and in Medina for 23 years, there were a number of goals and objectives that his religion tried to achieve. Goals and objectives in our lives. Now, these al-maqasid al-shar'iyya, the imam in this masjid, I don't know who he is, but if he doesn't understand these goals and objectives, he's going to make problems. This masjid has an administration, sure. I don't know any of them. If they don't understand the goals and the objectives of this religion, they're going to be problems. They're going to create problems. The husband, those of us who are married, if the husband doesn't understand the goals and objectives of the relation, he's going to have problems with his wife. And if the lady doesn't understand it, the wife, she's going to have problems with the husband. The mother and the father. The mother and the father, parents. If they don't understand the goals and the objectives of this religion, they're going to have problems when it comes to their children, especially living in Cambridge, living in Europe, in the UK. So that goes to show, even you young people, if you don't come to understand and appreciate and value the goals and the objectives of this religion, you're going to have problems. So it goes to show the importance of getting basic knowledge in the religion. Our Nabi al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us, طلب العلم Faridatun ala kulli Muslim. Getting knowledge is an obligation upon every single Muslim. And he wasn't talking about the knowledge that they're teaching in Cambridge University. That knowledge is okay, no doubt, it's important. But this hadith is talking about the knowledge of the religion. Everybody here, without any exception, there's not a single exception. Everyone here has to learn about his religion. He doesn't have to give the khutbah of Jummah, he doesn't have to give the khutbah of Al-Eid, he doesn't have to memorize all of the Quran, memorize all of Sahih Bukhari. He doesn't have to come and give a lecture, a lesson. He doesn't have to do that. But he has to know enough about his religion, where he worships Allah and he knows what he's doing. There are a lot of ayat in the Quran that Allah described the disbelievers, the kuffar of Quraysh, from Mecca, Abu Lahab, Abu Jahl. Those people were opposing Rasulullah. Many ayats that describe the reality of the Jews and the Christians and the Sikhs and the Hindus and the atheists. One of those ayats I want to bring to your attention is what Allah Ta'ala said, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى حَرْفٍ. They're those people, they worship Allah and they don't know what they're doing. Today is Sunday. You go to the church where black people go, white people go, any church. South American people, Latinos, go to any church. In the church that I grew up in, we used to tell my mother, before going to the church, we used to plead with her, Ma, don't catch the Holy Spirit today. Because if you catch the Holy Spirit, you're going to go crazy and act crazy. They believe that the Holy Spirit comes inside of them and they go crazy and they fall down and kick their legs and they scream and shout. People did that today on Sunday. They don't know what they're doing. They call that worship in Allah. I went to India, and when I was in India, I saw a Hindu priest. He barely was dressed, barely dressed. His arm was in the air like this, and his elbow went inside. It became inverted. Instead of being like this, it was the other way. He had long nails. His hair was looking crazy. I asked, what's the deal with that guy? They said he took an oath to God. He took an oath that he would keep his hand in the air for 3 years. When I met him, it was 2 years and a few months. And that's what happened. His arm became deformed and his nails were like that. Allah doesn't want that from that man. He worships Allah, he worships God. He's not even worshiping Allah. He's worshiping a monkey, worshiping a cow, worshiping whatever they worship. But the thing is, you may laugh, the thing is, you Muslim, don't be like that. Allah said, don't be like the people who they worship Allah and they don't know what they're doing. They have no idea. What in the world are you doing? Everyone here knows that Mecca is the most honored, noble place on the face of the earth. The Kufar, the Nasans of Quraysh, they used to be right there at the Kaaba. And they used to make tawaf and go around the Kaaba. And they used to go to Safa and Marwa. And they used to go to Arafah. Allah said about those kuffar of Quraysh, مَا كَانَ الصَّلَاةُ عِنْدِ الْبَيْتِ إِلَّا مُكَانٍ وَتَصْدِيرٍ. The prayer that they prayed at the house, those non-Muslims, it was nothing but clapping hands and whistling. They were just having a party. Don't be like that, Abdullah. I've been a Muslim since 1986, and I met Muslims from everywhere. From everywhere. And although the Muslims in our culture, in our countries, we have a lot of good aspects of our culture. But if you're going to try to practice your religion based upon what people are doing, you're going to be in trouble. You guys have to learn your religion directly from the source. Don't be like the non-Muslims of Quraysh, the Kuffar. Hey, you young people, especially you young girls. One of the practices, as you all know, of Quraysh was, if the lady became pregnant and she had a baby, the father of the baby, his brothers, his uncles, they would come to the baby, see what the mother gave birth to. If it was a boy, they had a party, they would rejoice, they would be happy. If it was a girl, without any questions to the mother, without any questions, they would take that baby girl, go out to the desert, dig a hole, and put that baby girl in the hole and put dirt over that baby girl. Now you have to imagine the psychology, the mentality of someone like that. A baby comes out, pretty baby girl. I have a daughter, her name is Arwa. Arwa, she is the apple of my eye. The apple of my eye. Someone had a baby girl, she has big, beautiful eyes like a dove. Nice long hair, her skin and her smile will cause your heart to melt. But because she was born female, the father would take that baby girl, defenseless, beautiful baby girl, put it in the ground and put dirt over her. Not even the mother would say anything. The mother who carried her 9 months would be upset. Now if you ask that man, Abu Lahab, Abu Jahl, Umayyah ibn Khalif, why did you bury your daughter? His answer is going to be, I don't know. This is what my fathers used to do. My father did it, so I did it. My father did that thing, and that's why I'm doing it. Allah doesn't want that from you. That doesn't mean that I'm saying here that your fathers are no good. I'm not saying that. I'm saying what Allah revealed in that Quran and what the Prophet brought in the Sunnah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it may not necessarily be what your father is doing. So concerning the maqasid of the Sharia, the goals and the objectives of this religion, there are many. I only want to talk about one today, only one, in my first talk here in the city of Cambridge. And I asked Allah to put it in Ma Mizan and Yawm al-Wazin of Hasanat Yawm al-Qiyamah. When we meet him, inshallah, we'll find these efforts in front of us. One of the goals and objectives of this religion is that the religion of Islam, the Ikhwaniyya, came to make things easy for you, to make your life easy, to make your marriage easy, to make your job easy. Everything that you're engaged in as a human being, your experience as a human being, Abdullah, Ahmed, Bilal, whatever you're doing, everything that you're doing, your worship of Allah, your existence. Allah, in this religion, that Quran and Sunnah, one of the goals and objectives is to make everything easy for everyone. There's no exception. Everybody in this masjid right now, in this musalla, Allah wants ease for you. He doesn't want ease for the men and difficulty for the women. He doesn't want ease for the Arabs and difficulty for non-Arabs. He doesn't want ease for rich people and difficulty for the poor and the needy. He doesn't want ease for intelligent people and difficulty for the people not so intelligent. There is no istithna, absolutely no exception. Allah wants to make things easy. But the people make things difficult, unfortunately. We'll come to that, inshallah. Now, before you as a person who's telling you, you young people especially, don't be a person like Quraysh, Kufar Quraysh. Jews, Christians, Sikhs, Hindus, people who talk, but they have no proof. It's just an opinion. Don't be like that. You have to always be sure that you can always go back to that Quran and the Sunnah and reference what you're saying with proofs. Indisputable proofs that are so clear like the sun in the sky. Because everyone here has an opinion. This guy here used to work as a carpenter while he was sitting eating lunch. A 2x4 fell on his head. There's something inside of his brain. He has an opinion. Do I have to listen to that as a friend to his opinion? It's not even, his aqal is not even complete. An opinion. Everybody has an opinion. But our opinion, it doesn't equal a fly in a snowstorm. You know that typhoon that just happened in the Philippines? If you've seen any footage of that typhoon, the tsunami, you mean the typhoon, those winds were blowing. I mean, they were blowing. If you can imagine a fly in that wind, that fly is insignificant compared to that typhoon. A person's opinion in the religion is like that. It's insignificant. When you look at his opinion, and compared to the Quran. So that's just your opinion. And your opinion doesn't mean anything if you can't reference it back with proofs. So what are the proofs that Allah wants ease for us? And why am I telling you this issue today? There are many proofs that don't leave any doubt in the mind of a person that Allah gave him intel. Allah said in the Quran, مَا نَزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لِتَشْقَى. Ya Muhammad, I didn't reveal this Quran on you to make things difficult for you. I didn't reveal this Quran so that things would be difficult. Allah said in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مُدَّكِرٍ. We made the Quran easy to be read, to be understood, to be practiced. Even if you're not Arab, Allah said we made that Quran easy to be read. So is there not someone who will come and read it and learn it? There was a companion from the Prophet ﷺ's companions, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. His name was Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-'As. He was one of the ulama of the companions. He narrated more hadith than every other companion, including Abu Huraira. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-'As, he was a zahid, abid. He used to read the Quran, that Quran, in one night, the whole Quran, every single night, the whole Quran. I can't imagine that. And in addition to that, during the daytime, he would fast every single day. When Prophet Muhammad heard about that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what? You read the whole Quran in one night? And you fast every day? He came and told him, don't do that. Because it's too much. Can you imagine if we had to read one juz of the Quran, just one juz every night, and if you didn't do that, you're sinning? Can you imagine how much sins we in this room would have? Not to mention the whole Quran. So those ayahs go to show the Quran is easy. The religion is easy. Allah said in the Quran, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمْ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمْ الْعُسْرَ. Allah wants for you ease and doesn't want for you difficulty. It doesn't want for you difficulty. That's a clear ayah. Allah wants for you ease. And this ayah was revealed after the verses of fasting. Allah wants for you ease. He doesn't want for you difficulty. He said in the Quran, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَن يُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. Allah wants to make things light for you. He wants to give you takhfif in your marriage, takhfif in your job. He wants to make things light. And mankind, they were created weak, Allah said. Created weak, Allah said in the Quran. لَا يُكَلِّفُ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِلَّا. Standing up the way we normally pray, Allah allowed him to pray sitting down. If he can't pray sitting down, he's paralyzed, but he has his intellect. But he can't stand up, he can't sit down. Allah allowed him to lie down and pray. If the individual can't do something, Allah doesn't make him responsible for it. We just finished and completed the fifth pillar of Islam, which is what? What's the fifth pillar of Islam? Hey, don't be scared, guys. If you know, you know. You should know. The fifth pillar of Islam is al-Hajj. How many people performed Hajj this year? Put your hand up. You performed Hajj this year? The vast majority of us did not perform Hajj because we didn't have the ability. When Hajj was made obligatory upon the Muslims, the Prophet came and told the people, Allah made Hajj obligatory. A man said, Ya Rasulullah, do we have to do it every year? He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if I say yes, it would become wajib upon me. So if I tell you something, leave me, and don't ask me questions. The Jews in the Quran is Surah Al-Baqarah, the verse of the cow. They were commanded to slaughter a cow. Allah ya'murukum min tadhbahu al-baqara. They were to just slaughter the cow. But instead of just going and getting the cow and slaughter, they were asking Musa all kinds of questions. What color cow? How big is the cow? Where should we do it, what day, and they will ask you questions, making things difficult for themselves. Not an hour, did you? Don't ask a lot of unnecessary questions and make things difficult for yourself. So the point is, Allah doesn't burden a person beyond his scope. That's a proof that Allah is Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, that he is Al-Latif, he's gentle, he's Al-Halim. From the proofs in the Quran to support what I'm claiming here today, because we have to speak with dalil and not with your opinion, is what Allah mentioned in the Quran. فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَسْتَتَعْتُمْ. Fear Allah to the best of your ability. Do the best that you can. You don't have to do everything, but do the best that you can. That's what Allah is looking at from you. That's what Allah wants, that you do the best that you can. What's beyond your ability? Allah mentioned in the Quran, مَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ مِلَّةَ أَبِيكُمْ إِبْرَاهِيمِ. Allah didn't make anything difficult for you in your religion. This is the religion of your father, Ibrahim. Now, there are many, many other ayat. Many. But we're going to stop there with those ayat, those verses. Someone tell me, why did I mention those verses? To prove what point? Can anybody share that with me? To prove what point? I want to prove. It's not my opinion, because my opinion, Abu Usama's opinion, with that typhoon, it doesn't mean anything. My opinion is like a fly in the typhoon. But when Allah establishes something, if you're a real Muslim, then you say, hey, now what we're saying, Quran, then that's correct. So we're going to put that aside. And there are many other ayat. We're going to look at the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hey guys, I told you I was a Muslim since 1986. I met all kind of Muslims, all kind of people who claim Islam. I met a group of Muslims who said, just give me the Quran and that's it. Just give me the Quran and that's it. I accept these verses, just give me the Quran and that's it. But those hadith and the sunnah, I don't want that. I say, hey, I know a lot of preachers when I was not a Muslim, they were liars. They were lying, saying Jesus is the Son of Allah. That they were prophets. They were saying all kind of lies. But the one who says, just give me the Quran and not the Sunnah, he's a bigger liar. Because you can't practice this religion correctly without the Prophet's Sunnah. The Sunnah explains the Quran. Look, you see the sheikh right here? If this sheikh memorized the Quran, him. Not only he memorized the Quran, but he memorized seven qira'at, seven different recitations. He's Mahir, Qari, an expert, Hafiz, and Sheikh. If you ask the Sheikh, for an example, hey Sheikh, you know the verse? Inna Allah Ghafur Rahim. Many ayahs in like that. Inna Allah Ghafur Rahim. Many ayahs in Ghafur Rahim. If you said to him, Sheikh, real quick, where's the last ayah in which surah? Inna Allah Ghafur Rahim. Where's the last place in the Quran? And without hesitating, he can tell you. That's how sharp he is in the Quran. For example, then you take this brother right here, and he knows the Sunnah, the authentic Sunnah, what the Prophet really said, the authentic Sunnah. He knows the Hadith and the Sunnah. If you put this sheikh on an island with his family, and you put this brother on another island with his family, and you say to the both of them, hey, you two practice Islam, you and your families. He's going to practice Islam better than him. This is just an example so you can understand. This one here, he's going to know how to pray. He's going to know what time to pray. He's going to know how to fast. He's going to know how to give zakat. He's going to know how to make hajj. He's going to know who to marry and who not to marry. This one over here, he has a general idea, but he's going to make a lot of mistakes. Because Prophet Muhammad came, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to explain that Quran. So if a person only has a Quran, he can't practice this religion in its totality. I just give you that as an example. So we don't divide or split the Quran from the Sunnah. That's just an example. So I gave you some verses of the Quran to show the religion made things easy. I'll give you some examples from the Sunnah. All of the hadith that I'm going to tell you, are Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, the two most authentic books in Al-Islam. The Nabi, he said about his religion, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna hadha deen yusr, wa lam yashad deen ahadu illa ghalaba. He said, this religion is easy. The religion of Islam is easy. And no one comes into the religion trying to do everything, trying to be rough and tough, being shadeed, mutashaddid, anif. No one comes into the religion like that, except that the religion will overwhelm him. It's just too much to do. Another hadith of the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ala inni bu'ithtu bil hanafiyyati sabha. He said, I was sent, Allah sent me with the religion that makes things easy for the people. Easy. I told you the iman of this masjid. If he doesn't know the goals and the objectives of this, of the religion, there are going to be problems. Look what the Prophet told the iman of this masjid and every iman. And he told you as well, when you pray. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا صَلَّ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيُخَفِّفْ فَإِنَّ مِنْ وَرَائِهِ الْكَبِيرُ وَالسَّقِيمُ وَذُو الْحَاجَةِ. If any of you pray as the imam lead other people in prayer, then shorten your prayer, make your prayer easy, make it light. Because behind you, behind the imam, is someone who's older, a sheikh, an old man, an old woman. Behind you is someone who's sick. Behind you is someone who has something to do. He has to go to work. On the day of the khutbah, Friday, the imam, he starts giving a khutbah, and he takes 2 hours to get the khutbah. He starts at 12:45 and finishes at 3:45. He's gonna get all of us fired from our jobs. And you can't say to the community, hey, you can't leave, because I'm reading the Quran and the hadith. You're gonna say, hey, that Quran and that hadith says, lighten up for us. We have to go, and if we don't go, we can't pay our bills and so on and so on. That's how the Nabi made things easy for the people. And so many other examples. But there's a lot that I want to say. So I'll start with those three hadith. And there are many, many, many other hadith. Many. So today's message is that this religion wants to make things easy for the people. It doesn't want to make things difficult for the people. There is another situation that comes as a result of this goal and the objective of making things easy from the maqasid of the sharia. And that is, we're living right now in a society and an environment that we don't apologize. You people, Muslims, you can't be apologetic about who you are, and you can't be apologetic about where you find yourself. We are law-abiding citizens, and no one should make you feel like you're a second-class citizen. You can hold on to your identity and who you are. Your name is Muhammad, keep that name, you don't have to shorten it, you don't have to bring it, you don't have to do anything. Never allow yourself to exist as if you are a second-class citizen. And don't have like what we call an inferiority complex. I don't know how many of you have ever seen, how many of you have ever seen the picture that the Christians use when they draw Isa ibn Maryam, Jesus Christ. Anyone ever see a picture that was drawn in the church, comes on TV, of Jesus Christ? Anybody saw that picture? Raise your hand if you see a picture that they say this is Jesus Christ. Anybody saw that picture? What color is Jesus always in that picture? What color is it? White. The Prophet of Islam, Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us that Jesus' color was closer to this man's color. He was closer to this man. He was closer to this man. That's what Prophet Muhammad said. He didn't say that to make people that color feel better than anyone. He was just letting us know that he speaks on behalf of Allah. As Allah said, وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. He doesn't speak from his own desires, his mind. When he speaks, it's revelation. Allah told him that. Now, what's the point about Jesus? About second-class citizen? About inferiority complex? Why am I making that point? When I was your age, and I used to go to church, And they used to tell me Jesus was the son of Allah. Every time I would see the white picture of Jesus, big picture, I would sit in the church. There was a big picture. Everyone in the church were black like me, everybody. But Jesus was white, the big picture, and had blonde hair and had blue eyes. I used to sit there and I used to say, wow, if this is the son of God, then that means God must have liked white people more than anybody else because he sent his son in their coat. That was my mind working. And that type of mentality helps a person to have a superiority complex or an inferiority complex. The one who is white can say, look at me, like they say, and Muslims believe this. Jesus, his ethnic background was, he was Jewish. He was from Bani Israel. That's a fact. So if there is someone who wants to say, hey, Jesus is from my ethnic background, that's the truth. I'm not going to dispute that. That doesn't make you better than me because he's from your ethnic background. But the Son of God, that's a big statement. Big statement. Arabs, 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 any Arab, especially from Quraysh, from Bani Hashim, they can say, Prophet Muhammad is from my ethnic background. I say, I don't dispute that. And I think you have some virtues because of that, but that doesn't make you better than me just because of that. And our religion addressed that. But the Son of God, the Son of God, it make a person think that he's a second-class citizen. Nobody can make you think like that if you're a real Muslim. Because the Quran addressed that issue. Allah told us in the Quran, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The best of you in the sight of Allah is the one who has the most taqwa. The one who's praying, the one who's fasting, the one who's doing halal, staying away from haram, and so forth and so on. So the point here is, we're in a society that is not our, it doesn't go with, it's not an Islamic society. So as a result of that, if a Muslim doesn't know his religion, he's going to find problems how to navigate in this society. There are some young people, some Muslims, who are rough and tough, and they are always having a collision in this society because they don't know the religion. Allah wants things easy for you. And this religion, if you understand this religion, you can navigate yourself in this society, in every other society. There are going to be some challenges, but you don't have to get a lot of knots on your head. I'm going to mention something. It's not controversial, but everyone knows about it. Everybody here knows about it. 3 months ago, this is just an example. There was a man, so not Muslim, was a soldier. A Muslim, they said he came and he stabbed him up in front of everybody, and then he started talking with blood on him, and they, instead of running away, he made an interview. And he told the British society and the whole world, this is Islam, and this is what we're going to do, and then, that's rough and tough. And that's not what Allah wants from us as Muslims. That's not what Allah wants from us as Muslims. He doesn't want anyone here to do something like that. And he doesn't want us to exist like that. Making those types of actions and understanding this is the way to be a Muslim and this is the way to call to Islam. Now, I've never been here before. There's a thing called hikmah, wisdom. I have to be careful about what I say. You elders, don't start twitching around. Everybody saw this issue. Everybody saw this issue. And if we don't address the minds of these kids, don't be apologetic and don't be extreme. Be a Muslim. Don't go too far this way, don't go too far that way. Be a Muslim. Our religion is clear. What the Quran and the Sunnah said is correct. I'm a Muslim, I accept that. And I'm going to practice it in this society in a way with knowledge, and if I have knowledge, I can do that. But if you don't have knowledge, we're going to be clashing unnecessarily. Now, when you are forced in this society, compelled, you're a person who has to fall into something that Islam said, don't do that. But you don't have any choice, you have to fall into it. Because Allah wants ease for the people, Allah allowed people to fall into those things. Because he wants ease for you. Something happens. How many of you drive? Can you put your hand up if you drive? Share, do you drive? Those of us who drive, you have to have something that they call car insurance. Car insurance. That means you're going to pay 100 pounds, 200 pounds, depending upon the coverage, every month, 1,200 pounds in a year. You're going to pay it to a company so that if I have an accident, they want to repair the damage of my car and the other person's car. If. But I may drive for 10 years and I never had an accident. So why did they take my money? How did they take my money? In Islam, about the money that's in our pocket. Everybody has some money in his pocket. Allah said about our money, لَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ. Don't take each other's money with falsehood. I'm going to sell you this thing and I know it's broke, it's cheap. I can't sell it to you. I leave my wallet in the toilet, أَكْرَمَكُمْ اللَّهِ. I forget my money in the toilet. One of you comes and finds it and you take it. Allah said, don't do that. There was a man, he was selling dates during the time of the Prophet. He was selling dates. The Prophet went to his dates and he put his hand in the dates and he found in the middle of the dates, they were soggy. At the top of the dates, they were good, strong, healthy. The Prophet said, what is this under here? It's soggy. He said, last night, Ya Rasulullah, the rain came down on the dates. It hit those, so I put them on the bottom, and the good ones on the top. When someone comes, I just give them, so he's going to be good and bad. The Prophet said, no, don't do that. You can't cheat the Muslim like that, or any individual. You want to sell a car? You want to sell a car? Somebody wants to sell a car. It goes where? How many miles on a car? A car has 158,000 miles. Before selling it, he opens up the thing and he puts 30,000 miles. He wants to buy a kilo of oranges. He goes, instead of the kilo, you know, the mizan is rigged. He'll never give the person a kilo. The way it is that whatever he gives them, he's giving them less than what he's paying them for. A religion that said, no, you can't do that. It's against this religion. Against this religion. So the insurance is haram. And it's a kabira from the kabair. But if you don't have car insurance and something does happen, you're going to get in trouble. So you're compelled, you're forced. Allah doesn't hold you accountable for that. He doesn't make you responsible for that, because if I don't have this car insurance, something does happen, I'm going to go to jail, I'm going to get in trouble, I won't be able to drive, and that's going to make problems and difficulty for my family. We can't take the kids to school, and we have other problems, and here I'm saying Islam came to make things easy. So if you're compelled to do something, you can do it. I give you some examples. And the reason why I'm giving you these examples, ikhwani, brothers and sisters, is that you can understand beyond a shadow of a doubt, Islam wants to make things easy for everybody here. So you have to ask yourself, I'm a husband. Why am I rough and tough with my wife? You don't understand Islam. You're a fitna. She's a fitna. My father, my mother. I'm a Muslim. I'm young. I'm a Muslim. Why are you giving problems to your mother and your father? Something's wrong with you. Allah wants things easy for everybody, and you're making things difficult for people. Something's wrong. So, if you have to fall into haram, Allah allows it. He said in the Quran, and this, I just give you three examples, inshallah. The first example is the easiest example. This is the easiest one, this first example about something that's haram, you have to fall into it. Easy. It's the easy one. It's about what we eat. Hey guys, you see this ring? You see this ring? We have any medical doctors here? Any medical doctors? Okay, you brothers, don't focus on my thing. This is just a girl, like a six finger, something like that. The ring, look at the ring. You know that our religion came and told us what finger you wear your ring on and what finger you don't wear your ring on? What material the ring can be from, what material the ring can't be from? In our religion, you want to go into the toilet, akramakum Allah, our religion told us how to go into the toilet, how to relieve yourself, and how to come out of the toilet. Now, do you think a religion that is so precise is going to forget to tell us how to worship Allah, who Allah is, what to do, what not to do in these big issues? The Muslim man can wear his ring on these two fingers, on either hand, on either hand. And he can't wear the ring on these three fingers. As for the Muslim woman, she can wear the ring on any finger. Our religion is going to tell us that and then forget to tell us who Allah is. It's going to be left up to us to try to come up with some hocus pocus equation. Our religion doesn't tell us the reality and the nature of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when I became a Muslim in 1986. I met some Muslims in the masjid that I went to when I met the Muslims. They would turn the lights down and they made a big circle and they put a green silk towel in the middle of the circle and next to it a white silk towel. They lit some incense, buhur, and they started saying, Allah, 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 Allah. I say, I say, and you guys are laughing. Now, listen, listen, I'm not trying to make you laugh. Look at it from the prism of the eyes of a Muslim. I was in Christianity, Jesus, white, and all that stuff. I said, I don't believe in that. I don't think God would send his son another code, this racism that's in this book. Jibril, Mikael, Ibrahim, everyone is white. Everyone in that book that I believe in is, who's good, he's white. And all the black people in that book were bad and they did nasty things, even the prophets in that book, and they reject Christianity. So when I came to Islam, I said, wow, Islam answers this race issue for me. No one's better than me. So I named my boy, my eldest son, Usama, after the companion Usama ibn Zayd, so that my son will know the story of Usama ibn Zayd, and he'll be able to walk in any environment, any masjid, any place, and his back is held up high. And he's going to insist that people judge him based upon the content of his character, not his color or his sex. So anyway, the point is, I said to those people, hey, what is this all about? What is this all about? They said, well, when we do this, Allah said in the Quran, Allah bi dhikrillahi tatma'innu al-qulub. When you make the dhikr of Allah, Allah, then your heart becomes sakina, tranquil. I said, okay, what about the green thing over there? They said, Khidr. It was with Musa, Surah Al-Kahf. Khidr comes, he sits on the green one, and Prophet Muhammad, he comes, he sits on the white one. I said, Allah Akbar. I said, where is that at? Where is that at? Before I can believe in that, where is that at? Where is that Quran Sunnah? They said, hey, it's what our fathers taught us. You just have to believe. I said, no way, Jose. I'm not believing in that. Do you think that a religion that tells us what finger to wear the ring on, how to go into the bathroom, doesn't tell us something like that? So anyway, listen guys, food. Allah mentioned, told us what we can eat here in Cambridge. He said, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمْ الْمَيْتَةُ وَالدَّمُ وَلَحْمُ الْخِنْزِيرِ وَمَا أُحِلَّ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ بِهِ والمنخنقة والموقوذة والمتردية والنطيحة وما أكل الصبر إلا ما ذكيتم وما ذبح على النصر وأن تستقسموا بالأزلام ذلكم فسق. Haram for you Muslims to eat. You cannot eat, Abdullah. You can't eat the blood from the animal. So the Muslim, when he goes and he gets meat and he cooks meat, he never cooks it rare. He never gets it rare when there's still blood coming out. You can't eat blood. You can't eat something that's dead. You can't eat pig, khinzir. Now I have to stop with khinzir. Listen. As a Muslim, a new Muslim, I was with a group of Muslims. I met those Muslims. Anytime one of their kids or anyone says khinzir or pig, they do like this. It was a pig. You have to do like this. I don't know. Maybe some of you know about that or not. This is a practice of some Muslims. The majority of Muslims in the UK. This is from their culture. The khinzir, the pig, you have to do like this. And then you keep talking. That's khurafat. You don't have to do like this to pick. You have to ask yourself, why did they tell us to do this stuff? We have to ask ourselves, you young, intelligent Muslims, you have to ask yourself, why do we do this? Why do we do that? Why? You have to be on a quest to know how to worship Allah correctly. So Allah said, you can't eat the dead, you can't eat blood, you can't eat pig, you can't eat an animal that has been slaughtered for other than Allah, you can't eat an animal that has been strangled to death, you can't eat an animal that fell off a high place and he died, can't eat an animal that another animal gored him to death, gored him, can't eat an animal in which wild animals ate him. Unless before he died, you came and you slaughtered, then you can eat him. But if wild animals ate him and he died, you can't eat him. Then Allah said, "Dalikum fisq." All of that, anyone who eats that, it is nasty, it's bad, it's sinning. You're fasik. Muslim goes and he eats khinzir. Hey guys, if you go to public school, and in that public school you're hungry, and no one's watching you, and they serve you with some pork, and you know it's pork, ham and cheese sandwich or something like that, and you say, no one sees me, Allah said that is a nasty thing, a bad thing. Don't allow yourself to eat that. Khinzir. That's a story of another color. When I was a Christian, before 1986, we used to eat pork every day. Although in the Bible it said, don't eat pork. Jews to this day, practicing Jews, don't eat pork. Jesus didn't eat pork. Real practicing Jewish people with their religion, they don't eat pork. So I used to say when I used to read that, hey, ma, look, right here in the Old Testament, in the book of Deuteronomy, you say, the swine is nasty, don't eat the pork. They would come up with ideas and say, oh, that's the Old Testament, but we're in the New Testament. That's what the Christians do. Muslims do the same thing, though. We do the same thing. And I'll show you how, but that I can wait. Now all of those things that Allah said don't eat, at the end of the ayah, now pay attention, at the end of the ayah, of the meat that we eat, Allah said, فَمَنَ اتُرَّ فِي مَخْمَسَةٍ غَيْرُ مُتَجَانِفٍ إِثْمٍ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. But if anyone is forced to eat those meats, if you're compelled to eat those meat, and you're not doing it because you want to do it, then Allah is غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Because you're compelled. You're compelled. In America, before moving to the UK, I lived in a city close to Chicago called Peoria, Illinois. It was cold in that place. And we were far away from Chicago, many hours away from Chicago. There were no halal meat stores. No halal meat stores. So the Muslims were forced. You either eat only fish or you become a vegetarian. But you can't eat anything else. And in the area, if they catch you slaughtering a chicken, anything like that, you're gonna go to jail for 3 years. And it was tough. Some of the young brothers, they said, okay, it's an opportunity to go into business. So the guy would drive all the way to Chicago to pick up the animals that were slaughtered and come back. By the time he came back, all the meat, it was no good. So we had problems. So Allah Azza wa Jalla, we found ourselves in a situation, what are we going to do? Are we going to become vegetarians? We're living in the environment, in the society. If you know your religion, you'll know how to navigate. But if you don't know your religion, you'll make things difficult for yourself. So that's the first example. Now that's the lowest example, eating pig. There's a bigger example. Now, I have to be careful with this example, but I want you guys to know that this example is in the Quran. So you don't act funny with me. I'm going to put it across in the best way possible, but it's in the Quran. So don't act funny with me, being all sensitive with a form of nifaq and hypocrisy, because what we expose our children to is worse than this Quranic reality, historic reality. But I will put it across in the best way. We're talking about how religion made things easy for people when you're compelled. In Jahiliyyah, before the Prophet came, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the non-Muslims of Quraysh used to make money in many ways. They used to gamble. They used to sell khamr, and they make money from khamr. They used to do highway robbery. You're a free man, they would just come and put you into slavery and sell you, make money like that. They used to do riba. interest. You take a loan from me, 1,000 dinars, you have to pay me back 1,300 dinars. They have a lot of ways of making money. Bani Adam, when it comes to money, he becomes very, very, he finds the ways. One of the ways that they made money was, if you were a man who had money, they used to have slaves, real proper slaves in Jahiliyyah. The man has more slaves than the amount of people in this room. He has slaves, men and women. One of the ways that they made money is they would force the slave girl to do al-fahisha. She would go into al-fahisha, tahara Allah ayyamakum. She would go to al-fahisha and then bring the money back to the master. When Islam came, Islam said, don't do that. This fahisha, even for the slave, is not good. So Allah revealed an ayah of the Quran, because what happened was, when the companions embraced Islam, everything Allah told them to do, stop drinking, they stopped drinking. Stop being racist, they stopped being racist. Stop being tough with your women, they stopped being tough with their women. You women, don't go outside uncovered, they would go outside covered. Whatever Allah told the companions to do, and that's why you young guys, hey, I want you to understand this message right here. Allah revealed the Quran. We all love the Quran. He sent Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He chose Prophet Muhammad. Hey, Allah also divinely chose his companions. It's not enough for you to just say the Quran and the Sunnah. That's not enough. Because every Muslim says Quran and Sunnah. The ones who were doing that thing I told you when I became a Muslim, they said Quran and Sunnah. Everybody says that. You have to add on to that the companions. Abu Bakr, Umar, Man, Ali, Kash, Bilal, Zayd ibn Thabit, Aisha, Fatima, all of those people were special people. Because when Allah told them to do something, they did it. Now, when Allah told the Muslims, don't send the slave girl out for fahisha, the companions stopped. But there were a group of people who were not real Muslims. They called them munafiqun. Does anybody know how do you translate? What is a munafiq? What's a munafiq? Anybody know? Good, this guy's put his hand up for every question. What's your name, son?
Hudhaifa.
Hudhaifa? Where are you from originally?
Palestine.
Yes, salam. What part of Palestine, Hudhaifa?
I can't remember.
You got most of it. It's okay. I'm going to choose someone else, Hudhaifa. What is a munafiq? What does it mean? Munafiq. Yeah, Arabic. This is an Islamic word in the Quran, the Sunnah. What's a munafiq? A hypocrite. They're the people who, on the outside, they act as if they're Muslims, but on the inside, they're kuffar. They're not Muslims. They were during the time of the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were a big threat. When Allah told the people to pray, the companions would pray, the munafiqeen, they wouldn't pray. They would only pray if they were with the people only. And even then they got up and they prayed and they were lazy. With aqamu as-salat, qamu kusala. Yura'un al-nas wa la yadhkurun Allah illa qalila. So they have many characteristics. When they speak, they lie. When they promise, they break their promise. He says, I'm going to come, I mean, wallahi. And he's lying. And he has the nerve to make the lie worse by saying, wallahi. Munafiq. Allah said, إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. The munafiqeen, they're in the lowest place of the hellfire. You know, Jannah, it has levels. Levels. The hellfire has levels. May Allah protect us from the hellfire. May Allah protect all of us from the hellfire. Don't let us come close to the hellfire. The munafiqeen, they're in the lowest place because they were a big threat. Anyway, the ayah said, don't do this to the girls. The munafiqeen, they kept doing it. They kept doing it. So Allah revealed the verse. He said in that verse, وَلَا تُكْرِهُوا فَتَيَاتِكُمْ عَلَى الْبِغَى إِنْ أَرَبْنَا تَحَصُّنَا لِتَبْتَغُوا عَرَضَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَمَنْ يُكْرِهُنَّ فِي اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ إِكْرَاهِهِنَّ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ مِثْلُ آيَةِ الْأُولَى. إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورُ رَحِيمٌ. Allah said, Don't force those slave girls to do fahisha when it's clear they're bleeding women and they want tahassun. They want iffa. They want izza. They want sharaf. They don't want to do this. Allah said, but if anyone forces them to do it, after they force them, Allah is Ghafur Rahim. Who is he Ghafur Rahim to? He's Ghafur Rahim to the girl. Because the girl, if she came to her master, Jahiliyyah, in that time, she'd come to her Sayyid, her master. She'd say, hey, I'm not going to do that. He would take out a knife and cut her. He would kill her. And no one's going to help her. So she's compelled. She's forced. La hawla wala quwwata illa billah. So she was forced. And Allah allowed her to do it. Now that's worse than eating khinzir. She was allowed to do that because of her environment, because of her circumstances. Now I'm going to give you this last example, inshallah. And the last example is worse than the previous two. And I'm going to finish with this last example and some parting words of advice. The religion is easy. And if you're forced or compelled to do something, the religion makes a way for you. If it's a question of life and death, and you have to eat pork, Islam says, live, don't kill yourself. Verses in the Quran. لَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا لَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ Don't kill yourselves with your own hands. Allah is Rahim to you. Anyway, look at this third example. There was a companion, his name is Yasir. His wife's name is Sumayya. And they had a son, his name was Ammar. Hey guys, I don't care, well I do care, but if you don't remember anything that I mentioned to you brothers today, all of you, then please remember, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is Mustafa. Mukhtar, Mujtaba. That means Allah chose him. Allah didn't choose Abu Lahab, Abu Jahl. Allah chose Rasulullah. He didn't choose you, he didn't choose me to be the Rasul, the Khatib of the Anbiya, the Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But just as Rasulullah is Mustafa, his companions are Mustafun. They're Mukhtarun. Allah chose his companions as well. Allah is telling us in this masjid right now, especially the grown-ups, Allah is telling us to pray five times a day. Get up for Salat al-Fajr. Tell them the men in this way. Many of us can't do that. It's difficult to do that. The companions of the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, radiallahu anhu ajma'in, Allah told them, give your money. And they gave their money. Leave your city, Mecca. And they left Mecca. Leave your culture, leave this, fight against your fathers, and they did everything. So it's amazing to me, it's amazing as a person who came to Islam in 1986 that I found that there were some Muslims in this world who cursed the companions, who hate Abu Bakr and Umar, who say that our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, Allah said about the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, النَّبِيُّ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِ مِنَ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَأَزْوَاجُهُ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ. Allah said that the wives of the Nabi are our mothers. The companions say, يَا أُمَّ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. So I found some Muslims, I met some Muslims who cursed Aisha and said she did fahisha. She did fahisha. You have to know your religion, Ya Abdullah. My mother who gave birth to me, my biological mother, she's in New York right now. She's a decent lady. Allah got my mother to Islam. Put her on Tawheed. Don't let her die without the Tawheed. My mother right now in Islam, in America, if you went to her house, you open up her freezer, she has halal meat in her freezer so that anytime any of my friends go to visit her, she'll cook for them. Give them halal. If your wife goes to my mother's house, my mother's not Muslim. I told you on Sunday she do the Holy Ghost, all that stuff. My mother on Sunday, if you go visit my mother with your wife, my mother is going to put a lock on the front door, put your wife in a special room anytime other men come in. Tell your wife, get ready, my son is coming, my other son, my brother, like that. My mother respect this religion. My mother, she protested for the Palestinians, for the Iraqis, and she not a Muslim. If someone said that my mother who gave birth to me, that she did fahisha, it's gonna be a problem. And my mother's not even a Muslim. What about Aisha? They say, Ya Rasulullah, who's the most beloved person to you? He said, Aisha. And here you come and you say, when the Mahdi comes back, your Mahdi, he's gonna raise her out of the ground and give her the hadith. Now you don't believe that. But you have to know, if a person is saying that, you have to be a certain way with that person. It's like me, if someone said that about my mother, I'm not gonna say, hey, come have dinner with me, hey, come be my friend. I'm gonna say, you better, what did you say about my mother? Because it's natural, it's from the fitrah, it's from the fitrah. You don't have to teach this boy to want to protect his mother. It's from his ilm, his ana. But when a person doesn't know his religion, he doesn't know his religion, if there's an individual who claims he's against Israel, he claims that because he appears to be like that, the Muslims say, yeah, that's the guy. Don't you know that guy is cursing the companions? Where's your understanding of Islam? You, where's your understanding? We have to learn our religion. The last example. Yasir was the father. Sumayya was the mother. The Kufar of Quraysh took them, tied them up. And the son, they tied him up. They started persecuting the father and the mother, taking a knife, stabbing them and cutting them, stabbing them here, stabbing them in their muscles, in the back of their legs, and their Achilles tendons, stabbing them in their thighs, loving the father. And then they would get salt and put salt in the wound. The Prophet will walk by, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and see them like that. And the Kuffar Quraysh would say, look what we're doing, Muhammad, look. And then all the Prophet would do, all he would do was give advice with his tongue. He would say, sabran ya ali yasir, inna mu'idukum al-jannah. Hey, family of Yasir, hey, the father Yasir, Sumayya, have sabr. If you have patience, you're gonna go to Jannah. Whatever the family is dealing with, whatever you're dealing with, just have sabr. Collectively, just deal with it, be patient. You're hungry, you don't have money, whatever it is. Someone is sick, can't, whatever. Be patient and keep practicing your religion. Your reward is Jannah. Now, the Prophet didn't jump in there and roll his sleeves up and he said, I'm just gonna fight the kuffar. He didn't do that because he was weak. His environment, he didn't have the ability, he was weak. Now some young people today, they sit there and they say, if that was me and I was walking by there, I would take them out, get all of them. You're better than Rasulullah? You're braver than Rasulullah? Allah's going to help you over him, not help him? He was teaching us. If you're weak, if you don't have power, if you don't have ability, hey, Allah doesn't burden you beyond your ability. Take it easy. Allah doesn't want us to throw rocks at tanks. Allah doesn't want that from us. The Nabi told us, Ikhwani, you know the ring I told you, going to the toilet? Then there was a man who was taking little pebbles and he was plucking those pebbles, just wasting time, passing the time. The Nabi saw him doing that. Mundane. It's a mundane issue, taking pebbles, plucking it. The Nabi said, hey, don't do that. He said, because those pebbles, it won't hurt the enemy. You can't use this in war. It's not gonna do anything against your enemy. And you're gonna knock someone's eye out or break someone's tooth accidentally. So he didn't let that man sit there doing pebbles like that. So Allah doesn't want us to throw rocks at tanks. That's not something we should do. He said, hey, be patient, Yasir, and your family. The Kuffar Quraysh, they got tired. These two, they never left their Islam. They were being stabbed, and they never left Islam. They could have been up there, and they could have said, oh, Kuffar, let's go. I'm going to change my name. Oh, Kuffar, I'm sorry. They didn't say that. They held on to their religion until finally the Kuffar got tired, and they killed both of them. They killed the woman in a way I can't tell you because it wouldn't be appropriate to tell you how they killed the lady. Sumayya, She's the first lady who was killed in Islam as a shahida. She's the first shahida. So that's a piece of information that all of you should remember. Trivial question. Who's the first woman who lost her life fi sabilillah? Sumayya. And that word Sumayya, it means someone who was high and exalted. That's the Arabic meaning of the word. Beautiful meaning, Sumayya. They killed him in front of the sun. They said to the sun, hey, we're gonna let you go. But we want you to curse Muhammad. If you curse Muhammad, we'll let you go. If you don't curse him, we're gonna kill him. He started cursing Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Started saying nasty things about the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because they were gonna kill him. So they kept their word. He came to Rasulullah, he was crying, he was sad. Mahmoon, Hazin, crying. And the Nabi knew they killed his, he said, what's the matter, Ya Ammar? He said, Ya Rasulullah, when they killed my father, they killed my mother. They forced me to curse you, so I cursed you. He said, how do you feel inside your heart? What do you feel in your heart? Your niyyah, what is your intent? What do you feel inside? He said, Allah, I love Allah, I love His Messenger. The Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at the Prophet, the Imam, the father, the leader of the Muslim, of the Ummah. He understood the maqasid of the Sharia. He said to that boy, in adu fa'ud, if they catch you again, the kuffar, they catch you, and they do this to you again, and they want you to curse me, he said, then curse me. So you can live. Self-preservation. And if someone curses Rasulullah, it's kufr, it's a big sin. If a Muslim curses Rasulullah, it goes outside of the religion. That's why we became upset and angry when they did draw Muhammad Day. The Ummah became angry, rightly so. But the way we showed and expressed our anger was the wrong way. Allah wants ease for us. He doesn't want to make things difficult for us. In Pakistan, Joe Muhammad Day, you know Pakistan, they lit the American flag and they lit a dummy of the president of America, effigy, they lit it. And when the man was lighting it, his throat got on fire and he started, and he put it, it burnt him up. Oh, I didn't want that man's arm to get burnt like that for that issue. He didn't want anyone to lose their lives. In Egypt, they killed the Muslims, killed a Coptic priest. In Sudan, they killed someone from the Red Cross. In Turkey, they killed people. They stormed this embassy. They destroyed this property. Allah doesn't want that from us. Allah wants the Muslim to be intelligent in the way he moves. Allah doesn't want us to be emotional. The woman, ikhwani, and this is not putting women down, but the way Allah created women is that He gave them those extra emotions because they need that to take care of the children and things like that. But even with that being the case, the lady has a responsibility of putting her emotions in check. And that's why if she loses her husband, if a Muslim lady loses her husband, if he dies, she can mourn for 4 months and 10 days. Everybody else in the dunya, if you lose your mother, your father, your wife, your son, your daughter, your cousin, your friend, we have 3 days to mourn. A man, he lost his mother. He lost his mother, and only people who lost their mother or their father knows what I'm talking about, the pain of that. He lost his mother. He becomes incapacitated. He can't do anything. He can't move. He thinks his mother or his father's gonna walk through that door. He can't believe it. He has 3 days to be like that, out of it, incapacitated, can't go to work, can't talk. He's a zombie. Islam allowed him to be like that for 3 days. After 3 days, he has to snap out of it. Doesn't mean he can't cry anymore, can't be sad anymore, but he has to wake up and start living. But the wife, she's allowed to mourn her husband for 4 months and 10 days because she has to let it out. Allah created her with those emotions. Did you see how our Ummah behaved when that issue happened? You young people, you can't be emotional like that. When you're angry, you're emotional. Hey guys, you know I told you about Jesus' picture? And you people raise your hand, many of you know what I'm talking about. Why Muslims don't get upset when they draw Jesus? He's a Nabi, he's a Rasul, and what they draw is not even true. It goes against what the Prophet said. So why would Muhammad be upset and with Jesus no? And Allah said in the Quran, لَا نُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ أَحَدٍ رُسُلٍ. We don't make any distinctions between Allah's messengers. We have to believe in all of them. Allah said in the Quran, كَذَّبَتْ قَوْمُ نُوحٍ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. Noah, he was the first Rasul. He came after Adam. Adam is a Nabi. Noah is the first Rasul. Allah said, Noah's people disbelieved in all of the messengers, although they didn't see the messengers. They didn't see the messengers. They didn't see Isa. They didn't see Ishaq, Ya'qub, Yusuf. They didn't see any of them. But when they disbelieved in Noah, they disbelieved in all of them. If you're going to get upset and agitated at the pictures of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and rightly so, we have to get upset with the picture of Jesus. So that begs the question, where are our intellects? Where is our understanding of the deen? What are we judging by? What's forming our opinions? How we form the opinion, the disorder, and then how we go about executing our opinions. So young brothers and you sisters as well, we are living in a time right now, where it's a fitna to be a child and to be young right now. It's a fitna. You guys are faced with challenges that I didn't have during my time, and I think I came up during that rough time, the 80s. But now, 2000, you have to learn your religion. You, brothers, 14, 15, we make an announcement, yeah? This guy, John Doe, wants to accept Islam. Come in. He's nervous. He's in front of all the Muslims. We say, repeat after me. And we start saying to him in Arabic, say, Ashhadu. And the man doesn't know Arabic. Why are you teaching him that? First of all, on the telephone, you could have just told him, just you and him. Okay, just bear witness. There's no God worthy of worship but Allah. I mean, this is his messenger. If he does that, he's a Muslim. But if he comes to the masjid, why make him say it in Arabic? When does the Quran and the Sunnah say he must say it in Arabic? Where is that? He has to say it in the language that he knows and understands. Allah makes you the Quran, many, many ayahs, clearly telling us this religion is for people to understand. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ. We never sent any Rasul, except that he went to his people with their own language. So in our masjid, we're going to give the khutbah in Urdu. We're going to give the khutbah in Arabic. And the vast majority of the people, 90% of the people, know English. And we're going to do it in Arabic? No. If the administration knows the maqasid of al-Islam, the maqasid, the goal and the objective of the Jummah is to inspire, to inform, to educate. If we continue to talk to the minds of these kids in languages that they don't understand, they're going to meet up with those people who are rough and tough. Those people want to talk about some truth, ayats of jihad, personalities, Ayyub, Salahuddin, Al-Ayyubi, Khalid ibn Walid, and those stories are true in their context, but we're the ones who run them away from the masjid to go, because they say, hey, these elders, they're on that old Taqlidi Islam, they're on that copycat Islam, that back in the old country Islam. Look how we make our religion difficult for ourselves. Look at this. The other day, there was a program on, and it was a really beneficial program. It was about a Somali lady who was trying to eradicate FGM. You elders, any of you saw that program? Nobody saw that program? I mean, I'm the only one who watch TV here, all you guys. Nobody had TV here. Is that what you're telling me? No one has TV here. Do you people know what FGM is? Other than the doctor, anybody knows what FGM is? Akhi, if you would have seen the program, it would bring tears to your eyes. They showed the non-Muslims, the lady brought non-Muslims into the tent, and she showed them videos of how in the Muslim countries, Somalia, Eritrea, Sudan, and Iraq, many places, Muslims and non-Muslims, but meaning most of the Muslims, because it was Somalia, and what they do to those little girls when they're born, when they're 6, 7, 8 years old, the khitan. And the khitan is from Islam, this is the khitan that's from the Sunnah, but they were not doing that, they were doing the Fir'aun thing. Where does that come from? Who in his right mind does that to his daughter? In his right mind, who does that? And the only reason why they do it, the answer is, this is what our fathers used to do. Our fathers used to do this. We make things difficult in that, I'm almost done. When people die. There's a word in Ikhwani called musiba. Musiba. Anybody know what musiba means? Hudayfa. Musiba. What is musiba, Aki Hudayfa?
It's basically something that happens to you that is bad.
Yes, salam. Hudayfa, what's your full name? Hudayfa ibn Umayr. Hudayfa. You're my number one student in Cambridge, Hudayfa. If I had some dough, I would break you off, man. I ain't got no dough. Anyway. Allah mentioned in the Quran, الَّذِينَ لَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. If a musibah, a catastrophe, if it hits a believer, he says, from Allah we come, to Allah we return. One of the biggest musibahs is death. To lose your mother, your father, your baby. So if someone says, so-and-so died, the people say, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. But you can say that for anything. You have a head, you could say, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Your child, the school calls you up and says, hey, Ahmed was fighting in school. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. You can say it for anything, but the earth, the custom is if we're sitting and we hear someone say, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, we say, who died? But it can be for anything. In the Muslim culture, when someone dies, look what we do. It's party time when someone dies. My relative dies, my father, my mother, last time I hold her. They die, musiba. Now on top of that, I have to feed everybody. I have to feed everybody 3 times a day. Not 1 day, 3 days, 4 days, 7 days. The neighbors, the friends, the relatives, people travel, I have to feed them. The family of the dead people. When Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, when he died, he's the brother of Ali, the cousin of Rasulullah, he died. When he died, Prophet Muhammad told his family, Prophet Muhammad told his wives, his family, he said, make food for Ja'far's family because they're busy with the musibah. So they cooked food and sent it to them because they're discombobulated. Now in our culture, if someone dies, I have to feed them 3 days, 3 times a day. And I have some knowledge of my religion. I know about Jaffa's situation. I know the religion is to make things easy. So I guys, this is taklifa. I can't do it. We're busy. The people say, Bakhil! Bakhil! Chef. Am I lying, Shem? They say, Bakhil, he's stingy. He's cheap. Why do we make it difficult for ourselves? Make the religion easy. Make the religion easy. Don't make it difficult on your children. Don't make it difficult on your wives. Don't make it difficult on yourselves. Your kids, don't make the religion difficult and life difficult. You want to buy a pair of training sneakers, shoes, something that costs 200-300 pounds just because it has some name, brand name on it. Don't make that a request that you're making from your mother and so forth and so on. We're going to stop here, inshallah, as we're getting, and we ask Allah Ta'ala to give us all tawfiq and to make it easy for us and easy for you. So I don't know if, who's in charge here? Who's the Ra'is, the Mudir, the main man in charge? Who's that?
Abdullah.
Should we answer some questions, Sheikh Abdullah, the brother Samuel?
Yes, sir,
you
can, yeah.
Ahmed, come here, man.
I just wanted to shake your hand, that's all, man. And you often, that's the last you ever give me for that, and the Kitab and the Sunnah.
It was throwing stones.
In the class, man. Aye, man. Okay, Khwain. If your brothers have any questions, inshallah, and your sisters, you can write your questions. If you have any questions, you can put your questions forward for maybe the next 10 minutes, I guess. What time is Salat al-Isha?
1:48.